Thank you very much for that kind introduction, and great to be here today. Well, sort of anyway. So as mentioned, my name's Adam Ferrier. What wasn't really mentioned was my love of radio and an ongoing love affair I have with the medium. It began when I was at university in Western Australia and I hosted an overnight shift on RTR radio. My show was pretentiously called Room 101, which was named after the torture room in George Orwell's 1984. And the tagline for the show was equally oblique: for music of a superfluous nature. I've no idea what that means. Anyway, I then went to Bathurst to work as a psychologist in the prison system. At the time, my name was Max. I won't get into why I was called Max, but anyway, that was my name. And I lived with another forensic psychologist, and his name was Mr. Feelgood. Mr. Feelgood actually grew up in Brisbane and was caught dealing drugs and had to spend 3 months in prison because Brisbane was pretty much a police state at the time. And so in order to get registered as a psychologist, he had to change his name, and he thought if he's going to change his name, he might as well change it to something good. And that's why he called himself Mr. Feelgood. Anyway, so that's that. So the two of us decided to host a talkback psychology radio show when we were in Bathurst on 2MCE. And people would ring up with their psychological issues and we would help them feel better. The name of the show was the wonderfully titled Feel Good to the Max. Mr. Feel Good and Max. Excuse me for a sec. That's better. Anyway. The music used to match the psychological issues we were dealing with at the time. So if you know, we're dealing with depression, then we'll play depressing music. If we're dealing with anxiety, we might play Alanis Morissette, that kind of thing. You get the picture. Anyway, my love affair with the medium continued. Did lots and lots of years with James O'Loughlin on Sunday night on the ABC, and also had a weekly slot on Triple M talking about consumerism, which I absolutely loved. Just going to continue this a bit longer if you don't mind. I now co-host a podcast called Black T-Shirts, which explores double XL creativity for business. All of our ads take the piss out of other ads on radio, which is a theme I'll come back to lately. And I'm also do a couple of mornings a week with Libby Gore on Enterprise Breakfast, which is part of Disrupt Radio, which is on Dab Plus. Blah, 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 blah. Very self-indulgent. The agency obviously does some work with CRA. We've also worked with for many years with the listener or SCA or Triple M or ARN. I'm not sure what you call it these days. But anyway, big shout out to Nikki Clarkson, who's brilliant to work with. So in this very, very long promotion and intro to the talk, I would now like to try to help you rediscover the power of radio by conducting this little experiment. All I need you to do is sit back in your chair and wait for this weird 15-minute intro to be over, and then I may join you on stage. But in order to do this experiment, we just need a couple of things to happen. Number one, accept that this whole thing might be a complete balls up. It might be, or be already balls up already. I have no idea. But anyway, if it does, then don't judge me. Two, could the tech team please just make sure that offensively large screen goes completely black at the moment and dim the lights in the room so that people can see those people around them and little else. Thank you. Lights dim. There we go. Wow, look at that. And now can you just fiddle around the audio and make sure it's at the right level? Thank you. Fiddle, fiddle, fiddle. All right. Now, for everyone else, I'd love it if you could just kind of go with me, go with the flow. Nothing bad will happen, I hope. It might even work. And first of all, if you don't mind now, just sit back, get yourself comfortable. And if you don't mind being completely silent for a while, any nervous giggles, get them out. Any weirdness, get it out. Put your fucking phones down. Thank you. And now, if you don't mind, just quietly turn to the person next to you and lock eyes with them. That's it. Just stare right into their eyes. If a person next to you is looking the other way, just turn behind you or forwards and make a little triad with someone else and lock eyes with those people. So you might have two people locking eyes, or you might have a three-way eye-locking situation. And just stare into their eyes. And as you're doing that, What do you notice about them? What do you see? Try not to worry about them looking at you. They think you're beautiful. They think you're amazing. They think you're wonderful. But just keep looking at them. What do you notice? And now just check in with your body. How do you feel? How's your heart rate? How are you feeling in your seat, et cetera. Okay. Now, just keep looking at them in the eye and I'll just start to slowly play some music.
When I start making love, I don't just make love, I be stroking.
And as the music starts to play, you might notice stroking. How your feelings change a bit.
I stroke it to the east and I stroke it to the west and I stroke it to the woman that I love the best.
Just check in with yourself now. Just how are you feeling? How's your breathing? How are you feeling?
Let me ask you something.
Keep looking at them in the eye.
What time?
Keep looking in the eye. There you go. And how do you feel? Feels good, doesn't it? No need to be embarrassed. It's just a feeling. And it's natural to have those feelings. Okay. And now, as the music starts to fade away, it's okay to look away and just get comfy and get back into your seat. Maybe a quick weird thank you to the person you were just locking eyes with or something appropriate, I'm not sure. Give them a hug or whatever. But anyway, that was experiment one. And did the music make you feel something different? How did it make you feel? I just want to now try one more thing, if you don't mind. But this one doesn't involve music, just some words this time. And for this one, I would like every single person in the room who identifies as a woman in the room to lock eyes with a male. Okay, there you go. And it's okay if it's a few women are doing this or one man, that's fine. Just lock eyes with a man and stare at that guy really hard. Again, what do you notice? What do you feel? You feel the man being stared at. How does that feel? Now again, and only if you don't mind, I'd like you to keep on staring at them as the following audio track is played. Maintain your gaze and don't look away, whatever you do.
I call the Prime Minister.
Thank you very much, Deputy Speaker, and I rise to oppose the motion moved by the Leader of the Opposition. And in so doing, I say to the Leader of the Opposition, I will not be lectured about sexism and misogyny by this man. I will not. And the government will not be lectured about sexism and misogyny by this man. Not now, not ever. The Leader of the Opposition says that people who hold sexist views and who are misogynists are not appropriate for high office. Well, I hope the Leader of the Opposition has got a piece of paper and he is writing out his resignation. Because if he wants to know what misogyny looks like in modern Australia, he doesn't need a motion in the House of Representatives. He needs a mirror.
Okay, there you go. How was that? How did that feel? How did you feel when those words were being spoken to you? The auditory sensation can be fucking powerful, fucking emotional, and it can move mountains. I remember in my early 20s being so excited when Triple J played this song on repeat for the entire day.
Yo, Dre, I got something to say.
It felt like it was part of something big, something amazing was starting to happen. And so what I want to say is that whether you want to start a movement, inspire rage, or you just want to make mad, passionate love to someone, what comes through the ears can be incredibly powerful. And I wanted to prove it to you just by taking a few minutes out to do that little experiment without me walking on stage or you guys having anything else to look at. And if you're into the power of audio and the power of radio, then as an industry, I reckon we should be doing this more often. Communicating without visuals and getting people to really feel what we're about. And as advertisers, we should be leaning into the power of the emotion of the medium much more than we do. And to just explain that a little bit further, I actually do want to resort back to video for one sec and talk about a TV series called Stranger Things. So yes, some of you may have heard of it. It's about a series of young kids who are basically finding demons who live in the underworld or the underside or something like that. And in one episode, a girl called Max is possessed by a demon called Vexna. And her mates want to get the demon out of her. And so they go to a mental hospital to work out the best way to do it. The doctor they talk to is completely obsessed with the power of audio. But instead of working at CRA, the doctor chooses to use the power of music to heal people. And he actually says in the episode that music reaches parts of the brain that words cannot. It's been established previously in Stranger Things, this young girl who's possessed loves the songs by Kate Bush, and it's this one here. The other kids, with the knowledge of the doctor that music can reach parts of her brain that words can't, decide, in a very emotional scene, that in order to save Max from being trapped inside their own head, they must play this song to her. And they do, and they play it over and over again. And the song kind of reaches into her brain and kind of acts as a lifeline to safety. And the song's played, she gradually reconnects with reality and expunges the demon. Now, this scene is obviously just fiction, but it's been written about a lot and kind of a lot of people have spoken about it. And perhaps the most influential person to do that is a woman called Dr. Indre Viscontis. And she's both a PhD in cognitive neuroscience, but she's also a professional opera singer with the San Francisco Conservatorium of Music. She explains that, I'll quote this, our adult brains are shaped by experiences. We don't turn over neurons like we do skin cells. Experiences accumulate over time, layer upon layer upon layer. We keep most of them for life. Music can remind people of who they are, of who they love, or of their past. So sharing musical experiences can help people reconnect again to who they are and reconnect to the present. And this is how the characters use the song Running Up That Hill to save Max and Stranger Things. And again, that's why this presentation is only in audio with lots of different sound files interspersed. I want you to tap into and just feel for a sec the power of audio without any distraction. Because if you can feel that and really feel it, then it makes me start to wonder why most of the ads I hear on radio sound a little like this.
Hello, Frank Walker from National Tiles. This week, National Tiles have a beautiful range of polished porcelain floor tiles slashed by up to 30% and more. Yes, until this Sunday only at National Tiles, save up to 30% and more on our beautiful range of polished porcelain floor tiles. But only until this Sunday. Rush into National Tiles now and save. Go to our website for details. nationaltiles.com.au.
And that was Frank Walker Tiles. And this, yeah.
We can fit Sting and deliver. No fuss. At the very best price. Doors Plus, no fuss. Don't wait any longer. Doors Plus, no fuss. To get the best advice. Doors Plus, no fuss. At Doors Plus, no fuss. Doors Plus, no fuss. At Doors Plus, no fuss. Doors Plus. Doors Plus, no fuss.
And that's Doors Plus. Now, both of those ads are great. They're really effective, incredibly well-branded, and I'm sure they work really, really well. I'm not knocking these as radio ads. They're building strong, distinctive brand assets, mental availability, you've got jingles, blah, 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 blah. But are they, or more importantly, is the industry missing a trick and not tapping into the true emotional experiences that audio and radio has to offer? And I think it does. I don't think we value the medium as it is. And there's three reasons why that's the case. And to talk about these, what I'll call distractions on why we don't treat radio with the reverence it deserves, I will walk on stage now. You'll see me as a distraction. There I am. That's Adam Ferrier. Can you please give him a polite round of applause as he continues this talk in person? Thank you.
Is this on? What the fuck was that? did that work or not? Great. Am I being a distraction now? I think I'm being a distraction to the point I'm trying to make. If I just go like that, When I Googled Adam Ferrier, which I want to do, that's the first image that comes up. It's fucking disgusting. These are my books. If anybody wants one, just come and grab one. And if you don't, then they'll just sit there during the day. So I just kind of did that thing, and I was hoping it would be emotional or weird or make you feel something. And now that I'm up here talking to you, it just feels cheap. I feel like this is just fucking blah, going through the motions, because I reckon it's distracting. I reckon when you just hear something, you process it much more deeply and you feel it much more. However, there's lots and lots of pressure to see stuff. The way all the seating is arranged, I wanted the whole talk to be just that audio file, but CRA said, no, you know, we're paying you to be here. Fucking get on, get on fucking stage. And so video content is distracting, but it's not just CRA who made me like do this. I think we distract ourselves with video content a lot. If I'll go to a pub and I see there's video content on the pub, I know it's going to be a shit pub. And you know, everyone's going to try to talk to you, get distracted, because we kind of expect it, we want it, we look for it. But the really interesting thing is, and this is a study, it was actually done by the University College of London, but it was commissioned by Audiobooks, but it's kind of got some validity, I guess, despite them paying for it. And what they did is they show people a whole lot of, they got people to experience audiobooks and listen to them, and then they got people to watch the equivalent thing on video. And when they asked people what was cooler, what was better, what was more engaging, guess what they all said? No, they said video, you fuckers. they said video was much more engaging. They had much more attention, they enjoyed the narrative, the characters were better developed, presence, whatever the fuck that is. They said it was much cooler. But what happened? They also did this while they measured things like galvanic skin response, their heart rates, their body temperature, which is all kind of proxies for arousal and for emotional stimulation. And what they found was they were much more stimulated emotionally by the audiobooks. So the video distracted them, but the audio created a much more powerful thing. Kind of like now, right? I'm flapping my hands around and shit like that, but you probably had more of an emotional experience when I was just talking to you. So video assets are a distraction for the industry. It's a distraction for ourselves. It's a distraction for media buyers. It's a distraction for everyone. Don't tell my clients who are... Anyway, doesn't matter. All right, so that's... That's point two. No, that's still point one. Point two is, I asked somebody about this talk and said, this is what I'm going to talk about. I said, what's the power of audio? And that person said, you can do the washing while you're... So the second distraction is it's a really useful medium because people can get on with their life and the advertising can just seep into their heads while they're doing the laundry. I got completely, you would have noticed I've lost a fair bit of weight and looking pretty good. I'm now walking on average 20,000 steps a day, which is fucking crazy. But what's got me through that is podcasts and just listening to stuff. So anyway, so it's really versatile. And number three, it's fucking cheap. So I asked Jim Ingram, who works at Thinkerbell, to give me the typical, who's got no idea what prices cost for anything, but I said, what's a typical TV ad nationally? He said about 50 grand, and a typical radio ad is about 2 grand. I know it depends who you're talking to and what your back-end deals are and all that kind of stuff, but roughly, this is kind of it, right? So it's a really cheap medium, it's a really versatile medium, and pictures can be superficially distracting. And so therefore, I think we keep on fucking with this wonderful medium by cheapening it. And all I want us to do is get back to trying to capture the feeling of radio. And if you're an advertiser, using that in a really powerful kind of sense, because it is arguably the most emotional and powerful medium. And if you think about any revolution or fuck the police and all that kind of stuff. They've got so much emotion laden in the industry, and we forget about it, and we fucking do with all, you know, Frank Walker, National Tiles. Really good ad, great guy, spends lots of money in radio, but, you know, we can do better than that. So, that's all I really wanted to say. I'm not opening it to questions, but I will just ask you to listen to this one last thing as well. Fucking self-indulgent twaddle. So don't worry about listening to Night Swimming by REM. That was ridiculous. Thank you, everyone.